This conference will now be recorded.
So we have great pleasure in having her over and we would like to listen to her experience. Go ahead, Annapurna, please start.
Hi, namaste. So it's a pleasure, during this lockdown to be connected with you and to share our story of the conservation of Jakhur Lake. So, as the topic has been given, it's about water security. And all of us know how important water is in today's scenario, especially in Bangalore city. We are seeing that we're running out of water and there's a lot of predictions that we're running out of water. How true or how much of fact it is something that only the data can confirm. But as of now, we know that there is a problem which is ahead of us, and how we can sort this out by conserving our lakes is what I'm going to talk about today. So to start with, I just want to share with you why these lakes are very important in this water security scenario. When we speak about groundwater and the bore wells not having water today and having to go more than 1,000 feet deep to get water, that means there is a problem somewhere, And Bangalore is fed only with Kaveri water from BWSSB, which means we are depending on some 100 kilometers away source of water. And, we are ignoring what is just below us. That is the groundwater that we have. And that's what we need to concentrate on today. So how do we then make sure that the old borewells, because I remember when we, had our borewell first in our house, it was just 400 feet and we were getting really good water. But today that is dried, the aquifer is dried and we don't have any water. And we are seeing more and more borewells going dry and then, more borewells being rigged, which means there is a problem somewhere. And we don't know how soon we are going to run out of groundwater. So how do we then take care of these lakes and connect them with the groundwater is something that I would like to share with you. So you all must have heard about something called as Jal Shakti Abhiyan, which is the central government's initiative to ensure that there is water and water security for all the cities which are water stressed today. And unfortunately, we have to say that Bangalore is also one of the 256 districts that has been identified as water stressed. So in that context, when the Jal Shakti Abhiyan visited the lake and they were sharing with us the 5-point agenda or goals that Jal Shakti Abhiyan has, they were mainly referring to, five important goals. And the one of them is, mainly groundwater recharge. When we speak about groundwater recharge, lakes are a very good way of recharging groundwater. So how do we do that? When lakes receive rainwater and they harvest rainwater, which is one of the agenda of Jal Shakti Abhiyan also, that is rainwater harvesting has to be done and then groundwater has to be recharged. So this both happens in a lake. So in a lake, we have the possibility of harvesting rainwater, and this harvested rainwater then goes into the ground and charges the aquifers which are in and around the lake. So this also, helps the bore wells and the open wells in and around the Jakhur Lake to recharge, and then people are able to use that for irrigation and their drinking water and their domestic uses. So this too is the important aspects of a lake. The third being, can we recycle our grey water and reuse it? So in Jakhur, we have an integrated urban water management system, which means our upstream domestic waste from Yelahanka is being treated by BWSSB and the treated water is getting into the lake. So this is also, one of the goals of JSA, that is Jal Shakti Abhiyan, to recycle grey water and black water, which is happening at the Jakhur Lake. And we are, having a very good biodiversity in spite of receiving treated water into our lake, which is again a very good role model for other lakes to adopt. We also have a constructed wetland through which this treated water passes, and that's how it gets further filtered and ensures that the final water is clean. And we have a lot of birds. It is actually ranked 6th in bird biodiversity in Bangalore, which means we are having very good biodiversity. That shows that sewage water treated is good for lakes to thrive and the ecosystem to sustain. So this is another agenda. The fourth point was water body conservation. So that was happening anyway in Jakhur, because we earlier thought it was a 200-year-old lake, but Mr. Uday Kumar, who's doing a lot of history, inscription stones and finding out about lake, he messaged me and said it's a 677-year-old lake, which means we are also traditional water bodies being conserved at Jakhur. The last agenda of Jal Shakti Abhiyan is afforestation, that is grow more trees so that there will be good rains and then we will have good water, which is again happening at Jakur because we are a 160 acre lake, you know, in which about 140 is water body and 20 acres is about trees and plantation. So we have a lot of trees, thousands of trees and lot of medicinal and herbal plants. And then we also have horticultural plants. So if you take, you know, the afforestation and plantation there itself, we have a huge plantation. So the Jal Shakti Abhiyan team, when they came to the lake, they were very, very happy to see that almost all their 5-point agenda was meeting by a lake. So then they said, if a lake can be the solution for our water problem, then why don't we concentrate and save our lakes and conserve our lakes? So that is one aspect that I would like to bring out today, saying that at the central government level, they have identified that lakes have the potential to become the solution for water-stressed districts. You know, so if we save our lakes, we have saved a lot of water for our, you know, the city. So this is the main aspect that I wanted to bring or, you know, kind of highlight, because all of us should understand what is the need or importance of a lake. Because to conserve, we need a kind of a good reason, right? Why we need to conserve a lake. The other aspect of lakes are always because in this urban space, at least in Bengaluru, we have seen that the green city or the garden city has lost its charm today. We have cut down a lot of trees and we are having more and more concrete every day. So in that context, I think lakes are our lung spaces. They are spaces or an asset of a community because that at least that much area is green. And then it allows you to, you know, kind of plant and grow, and also, you know, provides you fresh oxygen. So that is another aspect why we should save our lakes. And the last being, I think, in a you know, context of Bengaluru city, especially where you are kind of, you know, the expansion is happening so fast, or the development, what we call, I think these are the only spaces for people also to socialize and spend some quality time in a green space and, you know, get rejuvenated and, you know, feel a little bit energized at the end of the day, or, you know, if people are visiting in the weekends. So from those contexts, I think lakes become very, very important. So this was my first thing that I wanted to share with you, that lakes are very, very important. And the main thing that, you know, I'm told that Bengaluru was a city of 1,000 lakes, you know. So from 1,000, we have today landed up with 210, in which not all are you know, a living lake. Some of them are almost kind of gone or lost or on the way, you know. So we are somewhere not, you know, kind of making this important agenda in our life. Neither, I mean, when I say we, it's both governance and citizens. We don't feel the need of lakes, or we have not identified lakes with our water, lakes as water source, or we've not thought that when we don't take care of lakes, tomorrow we may run out of water. So I think the first thing we all need to do is, water is directly, you know, connected with our lakes. So somehow reviving our lakes will be reviving our water sources. And if, you know, you take Jakur Lake, it falls in a Yelamalappa Chetty series of lakes, which is finally connecting to the Dakshin Pinakini River. So rivers are also our source of water. And if we rejuvenate and revive our rivers, we also have hope of having more water. So from that context also, lakes have to be protected, because we are not just a lake, but we are part of a river chain. So this is another aspect that lot of us or citizens, I mean, all of us, when I started my journey also, I didn't have so much data and facts, where we never knew that so many things are associated with a lake, you know. So lake is more than what meets the eye. It is not just a lake, but it is a lot more than that. So this is one aspect that, you know, is very important, that for water security, our lakes and conservation of lakes is very, very important. So once we realize that lakes are important, then what can we do and how do we go about it, you know? So the second thing that I wanted to, you know, kind of share you with you is the three C's, you know, what we call as, what we have adopted as three C's. In that, the first C would be, you know, community. So when we speak community, it is about citizens, you know. So what is the role of a community and what can citizens do? Are we as helpless? Can we just see that borewells are not giving us water, go 1,000 feet, 1,200 feet, and then just give up and put our hands up and say, that's it, we have no more water and we cannot do anything about it? Or can we do something, you know? So in that context, I would say that citizens have a major role to play. So why citizens have to be part of these initiatives? See, the lake is a community asset. You know, when we speak about a lake, it is, you know, a part of the community. So whenever, you know, we have a lake in our community, it is like a pride for us. Like we have a lake in our community, we are blessed with a lake in our community. So the moment the citizens feel that there is an asset in their community which they have to protect, and you know, treasure, that's when the community becomes involved. But why the citizens have to be involved? If people want to use a lake for walking, jogging, bringing their children, play around, and do a lot of recreation and other activities at the lake, it's you know, the benefits of the lake is being taken by the citizens, you know. So when we feel that the lake is ours to use, the lake is ours to conserve and preserve also, you know. So it cannot be that somebody else preserves it and we use the lake. So that is something we have to really think about. Ki idu namdu, nam kere. Now adan nodkolbeku, now adra jothele kelsa maadbeku. So the attitude that the governance or the bureaucrats have to take care of the citizens, you know, the lake, and we will just use it, is probably not completely the right take to do. So then how do we involve as the citizens? So the moment citizens come to the lake and then feel the ownership for the lake, like this is my lake and I want to do something about it, that's when the first step to conservation works. So in Jaipur, what we did is, you know, we started with the citizen group Jalpo Ocean. So in October 2019, we met each walker at the lake and collected them together, and then they told them, so you are using this lake, do you think you want to protect this and conserve this? And if you believe in that, come and meet, you know, join a meeting on 19th of October, where all citizens are meeting to plan for their lake. And that's how our journey of Jal Portion started. So the community came together, we sat together, we planned what is to be done. And from there came two schools of thought. That is one set of people who believe that the responsibilities of the government and the bureaucracy or administration, and we will volunteer. And the other group said, you know, we are living in around it, why don't we take more responsibility? So we started with an informal group for about a couple of months, like 6 to 7 months, and then became a formal group through a trust, a registered trust of citizens. And today it's a trust, and we have an MOU with BBMP, and we are maintaining this lake in association or collaboration with BBMP. So this is how our journey started, when a few citizens who felt or loved their lake came together and said, we want to do something about the lake. So how, what did we do initially was just cleaning, you know. So for 6 months, we started cleaning up the lake, and we found that, the weird things were happening, you know, garbage in different forms was coming, which loads of dead chicken dung, sanitary waste, debris, then there was mixed waste. And every day we would see that something new is coming to the lake and landing up there. And that's when the informal group said, we should probably take a little more responsibility and do something about this. And so we registered as a trust. So the community has a big role to play. So then what do we do? How do you bring the community to the lake? That's another important question that we need to ask. And that's how we have a lot of events happening at the lake today to bring the community. Because we know that once people come to the lake, see it, they will never want to not come back, you know, because it's one of the beautiful lakes of Bengaluru with so many birds. We have 200 plus species of birds at the lake and so much of flowering trees, plants, medicinal plants. So once somebody comes there and falls in love with it, they will never, you know, back out of it. So then how do you bring them? So we have different programs. You know, every Saturday between 7:30 and 9, we have a volunteering drive called Shramadan, where people have opportunity to come and work at the lake. We have different events happening every Saturday. Sometimes we sweep, clean, compost, it could be de-weeding. Many things we do, you know, just to bring the community together, you know, because people have to come together to feel that we can work together, you know, just to build the spirit. We have art programs also, like every third Sunday, we have art by the lake where popular artists of Bangalore who normally, you know, kind of perform in Chavadaya, they come to the lake and perform, you know. Now, how does this help? There are a lot of people in the, community who love art. So they may come to the lake because they love art, but then they come there, sit there, spend an hour, and then they fall in love with the lake also. You know, so this is how we do. Then we have educational programs. We have Nature's Gurukul. We have Jalatarang. In Jalatarang, every month we have a community event for the entire community, like the local villagers who were here, you know, before. For them, like we have Rangoli, we have traditional games and things like that. So that these village children, village women are also involved in the, lake. They come to the lake, spend some time, and they also become part of the initiative. Then Nature's Gurukul, we connect with all the schools. We are trying to connect with all the schools, colleges, universities in and around the lake. So when we speak about the community, we have defined it as a 10-kilometer radius. You know, that's how we are doing it. So the first aspect is bring people. You know, once we bring people to the lake, you see the lake, spend some time at the lake, and you fall in love with the lake. Then you say, I want this lake. I don't want it to be destructed. I don't want this lake to not remain like this. You would like to make sure that you're contributing somewhere. And people who cannot come to the lake every day, they also have a way of contributing. We normally say that you can always sit back at home and contribute. How? By managing your garbage and managing your liquid waste. So solid waste and liquid management at home can be a big contribution to our lakes. Because solid waste that one doesn't manage and throws or dumps in stormwater drain lands up directly into the lakes, and liquid waste, like if any household connects their sewage to the stormwater drain, then that also enters into the lake, and then we really have an issue, you know. So we say that you can also sit back at home and help the lakes. And this is how, one way that people can kind of be at a distance, not come to the lake every day, yet help the lake. But community is very, very important. And this is the first C, that is community involvement or community participation or citizen participation. So we also have a lot of citizen science and projects running at the lake so that citizens have opportunity to come at the lake, understand the ecology of the lake, and then work on the project. Because then, you know, the citizen has this kind of a connect. Just to give an example, you know, when citizens plant plants, we get calls every day saying that, you know, I think my plant is not being watered, that, you know, is not being taken care of. So that is a kind of ownership. So when people are involved in projects and they have executed it, there is an ownership and there is a kind of a connectivity with the lake, which is the first step to conservation. So the first C is citizen or community. The second C, which is a more important C, is collaboration. Lakes cannot be taken care only by citizens because it belongs to the citizens, but it also has a lot of other components which are responsible for its management and rejuvenation and conservation. So when we speak about collaboration, we are speaking about connecting with a lot of agencies, the government agencies especially. So, broadly classifying collaboration, I would say there's a citizen group. Then there are all these agencies. We have some 15 to 20 agencies that work with the lake. And then we have, lot of stakeholders whose livelihood is dependent on the lake, like fishermen, grass cutters, cattle grazers, the home guards who are safeguarding the lake, and the people who maintain the lake. All these people, a livelihood is dependent on the lake. Then there is one more important concept today that we all are dependent on to conserve our lake, that is the corporate social responsibility. So we have the corporates also who, through funds and volunteers help support these conservation activities. Then there's one more important aspect, what we call as scientific social responsibility, SSR. You know, like CSR, there's SSR. What does the scientific social responsibility do? They don't give you money, but, you know, they have vast knowledge. They would be scientists. There'll be a lot of people who have worked on lake ecosystems, maybe biodiversity and different areas concerned with lakes. Now, they bring their knowledge and then help us scientifically maintain or conserve a lake. So there is a role for this scientists or the scientific fraternity around the lake also to contribute to the lake. So this is SSR. So these many people will be involved. So there'll be the stakeholders who are, the stakeholders will be multiple. I'll just show you my laptop screen just to show that. Yeah. So if you see this slide, the top one is all, these are all the government stakeholders. So like for us, earlier KLCDA was our policymaker. Now it is KTCDA. It has been replaced by KTCDA. Then there is BDA, which rejuvenated our lake. Then BBMP took over. So BBMP is the current custodian. Then there is, in BBMP also, we have various departments doing various things. So you have the BBMP stormwater drain department, who's in charge of stormwater drains. And then there is lakes division, which is in charge of lakes. And then there is, the zonal division, which is in charge of the solid waste management and other issues concerning the zone. Then we have BWSSB. In that also, we have multiple units, like the STP only takes care of the treated water, whereas the UGD takes care of all the underground drainage. And if the underground drainage is not taken care of, the sewage will enter the lake. Then there is groundwater authority, which is supposed to manage the bore wells and make sure that exploitation of groundwater is not happening. We also have the pollution control board, which makes sure water quality is maintained. We have the BESCOM, which provides us with the current electricity and then other issues at the lake, because without electricity, managing the lake is difficult. Then we have the fisheries department, who is responsible for the fish in the lake. So they are only concerned about fishing and fishing contract. Then we have police, the police also, because any crime at the lake or any kind of mishaps that happen at the lake, has to be brought under their control. And in Jakur, we are associated with 3 police station limits because it's a huge lake. Then we have a forest department also, because any wildlife like the pelicans, any scheduled birds, anything happens to them, or any tree related, like tree protection, tree cutting, anything has to happen or happens there, has to be brought to the notice of the Forest Department. Then we have legislative committees which make the policies or do, you know, kind of find out encroachments and other issues. So they also are important for us. And then mainly our elected representatives, you know, our MP, MLA and corporator, they're also very, very important in lake conservation. So, you know, these many departments, then we have the Home Guards department also, which provides us with home guards for the security. So if you look, you know, there are so many various government agencies that are associated with the lake. And, you know, today, as of now, we don't have a single point contact with these. We have to liaison with each department independently and make sure everything at the lake is working. So this is one set of stakeholders or I would say collaborators, you know. The second being the corporates, like I said, you know, the various people who give you funds and send, you know, the volunteers to work with you. And then there is the NGOs, institutions and experts for the SSR I was mentioning, citizens, and then there are stakeholders. So all this put together becomes the collaboration part of it. So, you know, when we speak about a lake, you know, everybody does their bit. Now, like in Jakur Lake, you know, the MP, the MLA, the corporator, all of them are doing their bit. You know, like our Krishna Bhairagoda is an MLA. He takes very keen interest in lakes. There are a lot of lakes in his constituency. Similarly, our corporator, Shri Munindra Kumar, also has a lot of lakes in his ward, you know. And all of them are taking interest and allowing us to, you know, bring out new ideas and then execute new projects in different ways at the lake. And this is very important. Only a good leader can allow good citizen participation. You know, by just opening up, you know, and telling us you can bring your ideas and execute it, that's very good thing about a leader. You know, the leader should be open to public participation, which is happening, you know, in our constituency and ward. So all this is very important aspect of collaboration. So when we collaborate, we need to build a rapport with these agencies and then find out what is the, you know, things are going right and what is not going right. And then sit and then, you know, talk to them and make sure what is our role in that. Like, everything cannot be done by citizens. We are not saying that, you know, when a citizen enters into conservation, we are actually replacing governance or we are replacing anybody. We are not. We are just trying to be one small piece of the bigger puzzle. You know, I'm trying to make sure that everything is being handled on time and things are working well, you know. So this is actually what, you know, is the role of collaboration. We all need to work together and make sure things are happening. Like, for example, the citizen group becomes a converging point. You know, like today, if our stormwater drain brings any, you know, sewage, immediately we call the stormwater department and tell them this is a problem. And at, you know, call level, we are able to handle it. Similarly, with the STP or the UGD department. So since we are all on call basis, like we have their numbers, we have developed a rapport with them, it's easier to, you know, communicate. Whereas when the departments have to communicate, it has to go through paperwork and, you know, there has to be notices sent, notices have to be responded, and a lot of time is lost. Whereas when citizens are working with the governance and the bureaucrats, it's easier for us to collaborate, even with our elected representatives. Elected representatives are very cooperative and they come forward and, you know, communicate and are able to, you know, kind of sit with us and make action plans with us and everything else, which is easier to work with, you know. So this is where the citizen and collaboration with all these different stakeholders happen, and this is another important C. The last one being, you know, the last C being conservation. So then conservation is equally important. Like I said, we have to, you know, make conservation our primary focus, you know. So when we speak about lakes, we cannot say that, you know, conservation is our only agenda, you know. So I am not the extreme activist or environmentalist that, you know, in that way. And fortunately, our whole community of Jalposhan, the citizens, believe that, you know, we have to take the middle line, you know, the in-between way. So we always try to balance, you know, balance between what? Community action. So we cannot always think about only pure conservation, because pure conservation in an urban scenario is very, very difficult. You know, this is the only place or space people have that they can claim and use, you know, as a kind of social space. So if you're going to keep it purely conservation, that becomes difficult. So then how do we draw this balance? So at Jakur Lake, we came up with a plan after consulting all the citizens. Any project, any decision or any thing is done through a mutually discussive platform. So we have WhatsApp today and Facebook and we are very fortunate to have the social media to help us communicate with the community. So we have more than 1,000 plus people on all various social media today. And then we throw ideas and we get responses from the community. And based on that, we work on our action plan. So what you know, we came up with is, you know, we also have a good mix of active environmentalists and people who don't understand the conservation and only are looking at community, like, can we do boating? Can we do this at the lake? You know, which is validated. I mean, from their perspective, it is fine. But then, you know, we have to do the kind of negotiation and dialogues with these people to say why what is happening and why some things are not happening at the lake. So that is where we drew a balance, you know. So today we have a small area demarcated only for the community and one area demarcated for the conservation. So from the gate, you know, about a kilometer on both sides, we have two gates at the lake. So both sides we have demarcated as community zone. And then a complete 2 kilometer at the back is, you know, kind of like conservation zone. So then what happens? You know, in the community zone, we have amenities like a children's play area, benches, fitness stations, whatever the community wants. Because though that may not be an ideal lake rejuvenation, you know, may not be an ideal way to rejuvenate a lake, because lakes have to be natural and they have to be more of a habitat. But urban lakes in that sense have to be a little different because people want, you know, something at the lake to come and spend some time. So the first part, that is a community, has all these amenities, amphitheaters, and they have, you know, other spaces where people can sit and spend some time to do some activity at the lake or, you know, spend some time at the lake. Whereas the conservation zone just has a pathway. So the pathway runs to the conservation zone and then we can walk, jog, but not use the conservation zone. So the horticulture department is, you know, aesthetically creating, you know, beautiful landscaping in the community zone. But in the conservation zone, we have only forest scape. So this is how we're trying to balance, you know, so that we have at least some space which the lake dwellers, you know. One important aspect here I would like to bring across is the lakes don't only belong to humans. You know, we are always the greedy people wanting everything for ourselves, you know. So we want to claim everything, the last inch also for ourselves. But we have to understand that lakes originally belonged to its dwellers, you know, the reptiles mainly, you know, the snake, the lizards, and then there are birds, and there are a lot of mammals. We still have a lot of mammals at the lake, like Indian mongoose. We have some jungle hares. We have spotted, you know, some peacocks, peahens of lake. So a lot of wildlife is still there, urban wildlife, what we call, you know. So they need their space. And if we give them some undisturbed space, you know, then they will thrive. And then we also have a good biodiverse space in amongst you know, us in our community, which is very important, because I think even this lockdown has taught us that you know, biodiverse spaces are very, very important, and coexistence, you know, that is another C within the C, I would say. Like, coexistence is about conservation. If you want to conserve a space, we need to learn to coexist, how to coexist with the snakes, how to coexist with our birds, how to coexist with the various insects, mammals. We need the honeybees. We cannot drive them away. So how then you learn to coexist? Just by creating awareness. So we do a lot of awareness programs to parents, children, saying that these need to be like this because of these reasons, and you need to protect them, and you need to start feeling comfortable spending time in such an environment. So the last aspect of C is conservation, and you know, kind of making a balance between community and conservation. So we have to ensure that both, you know, the humans have their space, but we are not claiming all the space for ourselves, and the flora and fauna of the lake have their own space, and they are also thriving along with us. So this is another aspect that we have brought out at the lake. And you know, as of now, we've been successful. People have been able to understand the concept. You know, this needs a lot of dialogues and negotiations, of course, because even today we have a mud pathway running through the lake. So a lot of walkers and lake users keep asking, when is development going to happen? When are you going to tar it? Or when are you going to put the interlock blocks? And we have to kind of tell them, you know, that is not what is happening, because it's important to have mud pathway because it harvests rainwater, as well as it's very good for your knees. And then all this kind of awareness is very, very required when people have to start understanding the ecosystem and why what is done. That is a little bit challenging because you cannot stand at the lake and talk to every user. So whenever you find an opportunity, you can converse or dialogue with them. But sometimes you may not be able to reach out to every person in the community. But here I would say, you know, we are very, very happy that BBMP has a very good environmentally sustainable model. Like they are pro all these things. You know, they want mud pathway. They are supportive of environmental or ecological projects or eco-sensitive. So I think, you know, it is not, administration always doesn't, is not in the kind of, you know, development mode only. But maybe somebody pushes them to always take the developmental stand, which I think we also be responsible for. For as citizens, if our community stands and say, I don't want development in the concrete sense, I want development in a very eco-friendly way, I think BBMP supports it. Because all our projects at the lake, which are more eco-friendly in nature, we use more of eco-friendly materials for doing whatever we do. BBMP has supported us completely. Our MLA has supported us completely. Our corporator has supported us completely, saying that that's a good idea and go ahead and do it, which is again very important. All these people have to be with you, you know, on your ideas. When I say you, the community. So they have to, you know, have a sync with the community ideas and support it. And only this collaboration can bring about important changes in this conservation model. Otherwise, we can go the very developmental way, have too many concrete things happening at the lake, too many gazebos, making an interlock pathway among the lake, which is not needed. Actually, it's absolutely not needed. It may have its own problems. Like, you know, when it rains really, on a heavy rainy day, the pathway does become a little damp and sometimes a little mushy if there's a water logging, but that's just for a day. So I think citizens have to understand that if I don't use the lake for about a month also in a year because of rains, but I can use it the other days in a very eco-friendly way, I should adopt the eco-friendly way of development, which is something that we need to understand, you know. So these are things that again come only through talking. So every opportunity we get, we try to, you know, pass on these ideas, we try to sensitize people, we try to tell them why things are the way they are. So slowly now the community has warmed up and everybody believes in this action plan that we should maintain a balance, we should not go concrete. And a lot of people have expressed that they come all the way to Jakhur Lake only because they still feel there is a lot of nature there. You know, everything looks natural, there is forestscape, everything looks a little wild, and we like it. They say, why do we need to go all the way to a forest when we have something in our city which looks a little wild, you know, let it remain. So there are a lot of people who also, you know, support this forestscape concept. You know, they really love to see an urban forest within a city. So it all depends on, you know, whether you can make your community understand why you're doing what you're doing, and consult it. Always consult the community. You know, any idea has to come from the community and has to be executed by the community. You know, so this is the way it happens. So how does all this work out? You know, we do it through funds. So major infrastructure happens through BBMP only. So BBMP has done all the major infrastructure that is required for the conservation of the lake. Minor things, you know, like some aspirational projects like children's play area and other things, we do it through CSR funds. Again, it's not because BBMP doesn't support you or your MLA and corporator don't give you fund. Not like that. They're also ready, but you know, when it comes through a governance agency, there are some procedures, tenders and everything else. Whereas when we do it through CSR funds, we have a little flexibility of bringing in new ideas and executing it in a little innovative and creative way. So because of that reason, we prefer small projects to be done on our own through CSR funds, because that gives us a little open space to, you know, execute projects the way the community wants it to be executed. So this is, you know, the kind of a model. And just to end up, I would just like to tell how, you know, that whole award thing went about. So when we speak about the JSA award that we won, it was mainly for promotion of citizen and state action. So, you know, the Jal Shakti Abhiyan, I was very happy to see that there is a proactive, you know, citizen and government collaboration that's happening. Because they were saying all around, you know, they look at a national scenario, lot of work is always done by the bureaucrats or the administration or the governance. So if they don't take interest, nothing happens. But they're very happy that when citizens involve, it becomes a very dynamic way of working, a more, you know, kind of a democracy at work kind of a thing, where citizens are actively involved and working. So they were very happy about this collaboration of governing agencies, elected representatives, community, the scientific fraternity, and the corporate, all coming together and working for conservation of a lake. And they said that if this model is replicated, it will be very good to save all the lakes, not only in Bengaluru, but maybe across the nation. And it was a real proud moment for us that, you know, the lot of hard work and the community's so much of involvement in the lake was finally being recognized and appreciated at the national level, you know. And immediately, you know, followed by that was Central Ground Board. You know, they asked us to write our success story, and they published it as one of the success, 13 success story for water, you know, groundwater preservation. And that was also kind of a motivation for us, you know. So these kind of things are just motivation. It doesn't say that we have completed our work, because conservation is an ongoing process. It is something that probably will pass on from us to our next generation to take the baton and move ahead. We cannot complete conservation in a few years. It is because a lake is a living system. You know, it keeps changing. There is something happening every day. So you cannot say I'm done with conservation. But today we are happy that we are able to achieve all the three C's, where slowly things are working and a system is in place today. And we are moving ahead in the journey of our conservation. So this is what I had to share with you. I can go on for a long time because, you know, this becomes a passion, and then it becomes kind of a part of you when you start working with lakes, and you can talk for hours. But yeah, I have some time constraints which I need to keep to. So I will, you know, kind of end here, opening it up for questions.
Thank you, Annapurna. I could really see that you were very passionate about the work that you've carried out. I can see two questions on the side window. Well, Lali, why don't you go ahead and ask it directly? Pradeep, I agree, Ramaswamy, it was fantastic work and fabulous presentation. I think there was a lot more work behind it than what she summarized in. And we would like to open the floor for questions. Lali, why don't you go ahead and ask your question? Lali, are you there? Or okay, and let me read out her question. Is there any truth in saying that eucalyptus trees drain out water from the soil? There is a lake site that is shown as water body by BBMP named Jannasandra Lake, adjacent to her layout. There used to be no water earlier. But now there's no water. This is under litigation and full of grown up eucalyptus trees. Is there any truth in this?
I mean, during my research days, because most of my knowledge, I'm not from a science, the ecology background. So most of my knowledge comes from experience. A lot of people say that the eucalyptus tree has a capacity to take its root deep and pull water from everywhere. So that is more of a survival skill of the tree, you know. So obviously, when you have a lot of eucalyptus tree around the lake, it has a tendency to drain the water, around the lake, because it will push its roots to anywhere that it can find water and take the water for its survival, you know. So that is something that is true. But, it's not a negative thing about the tree. It's just that we need to plan and plant it in the right place.
I'm Subhu Hegde here from Arekere Lake Trust. We have started this rejuvenation effort by about 8 years ago. The citizen group, but then we did achieve some success, like got the whole lake fenced and all that. But removal of some of the encroachments and further work has not happened for last 3-4 years, mainly because of the some vested interests trying to capture that area, and there is also a legal case in the High Court, which the BDA and the Tahsildar, if they want, they can get it closed and continue the work, but they're not cooperating. So I was wondering if Jal Shakti Abhiyan can help us in continuing this rejuvenation effort. It's a 35-acre lake, but already a little encroachment has happened, and further encroachment is likely to happen unless somebody helps us.
Yeah, so, with regard to this, it's very lake specific, because I think, we are in North Bangalore, which, the citizen group was in place much ahead of time. So we don't have those major issues that you all are facing on the other side of the city. Fortunately, Jakur is a zero encroachment lake. We don't have any encroachments. That's because the BDA had fenced it ahead of time. So I think, we need to get in touch with our custodians and ensure that is happening, and maybe a little bit of push from the citizens. And then, citizens also take, here in Jakur, whenever we see that anybody has brought, anybody's trying to break the fence or come inside, do any kind of illegal activities, we first of all try to talk to them, the developers or the contractors, whoever is at the site. And if, they are not cooperative, like most of the time they're able to handle at our level. If it is not possible, then we do file a complaint with KSPCB or BBMP, a zonal office, where then they send the engineers, and then you know, but the continuous follow-up is required. You know, sometimes what happens is, because we all understand how the whole system works, you know, in a big city and especially in the capital, there will be vested interests, there will be a lot of influential people trying to. So the citizens have to be doing continuous follow-up. That's what we do, you know, continuously follow up and then make sure that some action is taken. And in the worst case scenario, there's always something that all citizens can protest or, you know, bring some activism into place. But that is the last resort. When nothing else works, that also can happen. But a continuous pushing will be required with any agencies. So if it is a tahsildar, you need to go talk to them and then ensure that they are with you. Like today, if I say what is working for us when we are collaborating with governing agencies is, we always are, you know, we are with them. You know, it's not like we've never put them at the defensive saying that you're not doing your work. We always say that how we can achieve it. Do you need our support to get something done and can we work together? So I know this may work. I'm not too sure whether it's a universal thing that can work anywhere in Bangalore. It has worked for us most of the time.
I think the local MLA and cooperator support is very crucial. Without that, it's difficult to make
it. Yeah, very true. Because, you know, here we get for any problem, you know, our MLA writes letters to the governance and everything else, and the cooperator helps us. So that is also very, very important. MLA support and they believing in the cause of conservation of lakes is important. Here, both of them are very involved with lakes. That is an advantage for us. So that again may be a very specific thing for our ward and constituency. I'm not sure whether it is across Bangalore.
Thank you. Your presentation or talk covered almost everything that we wanted to know. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Hello. This is Gautam Kamat here.
Hello.
Yeah. I'm Gautam Kamat here from Ward 184, Bangalore South. I just want you to put something across on maintenance aspect. How the budget is done, which department takes care of the maintenance of all these, your particularly Jakur Lake? Funding, how it is done?
Maintenance budget, is it?
Yes, I'm talking about maintenance. Yes.
A maintenance budget, right?
Correct. I'm talking about maintenance and who takes care of it.
Yeah, so, you know, this when you sign an MOU with BBMP, the understanding is that whoever is signing the MOU will take care of the monthly maintenance. So basically, we all know how in our, you know, budgets every year, lakes are not given as much importance as they deserve, you know. So most of the time, the budget is not enough to take care of 210 lakes. So there is rejuvenation that has to happen. And then every lake that has been rejuvenated has to be maintained. You know, so the maintenance budget is equally huge and is consistently required because that's a recurring cost. And most of the time, BBMP doesn't have it. And that is why they are involving citizens into this. So the maintenance is being borne by Jalposhan today for Jakur Lake. So it's a 160-acre lake, which is a huge lake. So we need at least about a lakh minimum, 1.5 to 2 lakhs every month. You know, because it involves having some, you know, 10 people to clean the lake, garden maintenance and everything else, water body maintenance and, you know, a little bit of tools and everything else. So it works out about 25 lakhs a year, which we are working only through CSR. So we contact all these corporates and then make sure that some CSR funds are coming for the maintenance of the lake. So as of now, this is the scenario. But, you know, this is something that we have taken up so that we are not losing a beautiful lake. But down the line, I think all citizen groups which are taking care of lakes should join together and demand from the government that whenever you rejuvenate a lake, you have to ensure that there is maintenance fund to make sure that the rejuvenated lake doesn't die down after some years because there is no maintenance. So I think this is the way forward. But as of now, we have been able to sustain it. This is our fifth year of adoption of the lake. We've been able to sustain this. And sometimes, yes, we have to do some judicious spending and then a little bit of good money management and then a little bit of going around with a begging bowl to get a little more funds. So these kind of things keep happening, but that's because, you know, we're still achieving a consistent way of doing this. Probably in the next few years, we'll figure out how to get a consistent maintenance fund. But finally, the responsibility should lie with the governance is what I feel, because not all citizens group can sustain the maintenance fund, which is huge for big lakes.
Yeah, thank you. This is what the BNP will have to address once as a corporators. Thank you. Yeah, thanks for the input. Yeah.
Which is department taking care of BNP lakes? Which department in the BNP takes care of this? Which department in BNP is in
Lakes Division?
Lakes Division, yeah.
Lakes Division. There's a BNP Lakes Division, yeah.
Yeah. Annapurna, can I ask you a question? This is Anish Sadanand from HSR. Now, tell when me, you Anish. Said, Annapurna, when you said that BBMP rejuvenated the lake, have they done any scientific rejuvenation or beautification of the surroundings and digging the lake up? What is your take on the scientific rejuvenation of the lake?
Yeah, so this lake was not rejuvenated by BBMP. It was rejuvenated by BDA. But yes, okay. They have taken up a scientific approach in, I would say the design and the overall planning was scientific, but then a little bit of civil engineering work has happened where some flaws are there, the good points. I would just like to bring out the good points. Yeah. We have integrated urban water management system, which means the SCP is pumping in water. We have a constructed wetland, which was the first of its kind in Bangalore and all over India also, I think. So these were good scientific things that BDA has brought into the design. Sometimes the stone pitching in the revetment and then not giving a gradual slope, we have lost a shoreline, So we don't have a shoreline in Jaipur. And we were losing shoreline birds. That is why we have compensated it by leaving about 2 to 3 feet of weeds in the water. So the birds perch on these weeds and then feed it. So we yet to get shoreline birds. So some design flaws are there. So I wouldn't say it's totally, it was not a completely ecological or scientific design in that very sense. But I would say 80% it's good. We don't have that much major issues. But some things could have been changed, which we do tell the BDA and BBMP now that in new lakes, probably they can make some changes. So we do share our ideas and thoughts with the SWD department and the lakes division also.
There are some points which, a scientific paper, me and Dr. Aditya Singh had submitted to Seema Garg. At that time, she was the CEO of Lake Development Authority. And before Agra Lake, and I think so. Some of the points they have covered, BDA has covered in this. When you say a rejuvenation of lake, the fauna and flora they miss out on that. Okay, so I think so. Some points even Subbu can note down. Because I think so, they are in the process of rejuvenating his area, the lake. I think so. The things that BBMP or the lake development or BDA miss out is the plants that have to go into the lake. Specific species of plants are there at different levels of the water. Okay. Then the fish which are there in the lake, there are different species at different depths of water in a lake. So each fish species does a particular function to keep the lake in pristine condition. So that is one aspect. Another point here is none of the Indian fish species, they don't multiply in lakes. So one major point that most of the agencies miss out is these fishes do not breed in lakes. They need fresh water. They need they breed in river systems, except one exception we found in Manali, where the Maasai has spawned. They were breeding in the lake. Apart from that, so when generally any government agency takes up rejuvenation of lakes, one is the flora, and second is the fish species have to be replenished. Every year or every alternate year, fingerlings have to be released back into the lake. So this is one couple of aspects that they miss out. And then anything have they done regarding the water quality monitoring? Is there any apparatus to monitor the quality of water?
So here at Jakkur, answering both your points, one is about, you are right about species, you know, like in Bangalore, we don't have native species, fish species, especially in the water, because the fisheries department is in charge of all these lakes, and then they would breed fish which has a value, you know. So the native fish normally is lost, and then there are fingerlings brought. But, you know, then that is one aspect about fish that you mentioned. But plants, yes, we do plant a lot of native trees. And then bird species obviously will be native, and then there'll be migratory birds that come. And other, you know, fauna will be all native fauna, except for the fish, which is not under our control because of various departments being in charge of a lake. So every aspect is, you know, somebody else's responsibility. So there is no, place where people sit together and discuss, you know. So this is one negative thing about fishes in the lake, that I do agree with you. You know,
but I just interrupt you. I think so. You can give this feedback to the fisheries department because y'all are managing it so well. And all hats off to you, all the government departments. It's very difficult to coordinate with them, but you're managing it. The fisheries department can be told it is scientifically proven that, there is, when you said native species, there is no native species for lakes specific. Okay, in India, okay, most of the lakes, especially in India, all are in Bangalore, all are man-made, and when it was created, the different species of fish which were found in the rivers have been put in the lakes. Okay, so there is no need of going to the thing of finding out what the native species of the lake was. You can put a mixture of
We are in conversation with the fisheries department, so we are trying to work with them. So there is, I know about water quality, what you spoke about. KSPCB does regular monitoring, and then we have since AP is very close to Jakkur Lake, they are completely involved in the scientific they do the scientific assessment and give us advice about what is to be done with the lake. So we also have NCBS, GKVK very close to our lake. So we get a lot of scientific inputs from these people. So we are working with all these people to see what is the best thing to do for the lake. So that is how we have a lot of, people advising us on what to plant, which birds to attract, how to attract those birds, you know. So even fishing, we're trying to talk to the fisheries department now. But as you said, yes, whatever is there, the fingerlings are being brought into the lake, released on time, they're being spawned there. So all that is happening. So we have fishermen at the lake who do fishing regularly and have a livelihood out of it. So that is all working fine when we speak about the fisheries department provided fishes. What I'm speaking about is, some of the environmentalists do mention about the native fishes, which probably we have lost. We don't even have data what they were or what were the original fishes at this lake earlier, you know.
If I may interrupt, I think maybe we should let a couple of others also ask their questions. Yashaswin has a question on, it's an interesting question of how many lakes should be there per ward if you want to make this very sustainable ecosystem all over Bangalore.
How many lakes is it?
Should there be a lake in every ward, or how would you go about it? What is the minimum area required for a lake to be formed? To have a sustainable ecosystem, should there be many lakes in a ward, or how many in a ward?
So here in, since in Bangalore, we don't have much space, new lakes are not possible to make. So ward, we are fortunate to have a lot of lakes because the series, the Ellamellappa Chetty series, most of the lakes are in our ward, so that is one advantage. But when you ask about the size of the lake, it can be as small as 10 acres or it can be as big as 300, 900 like Velandur for a good biodiversity. So the size of the lake is not important. How well it is designed and how much of the ecosystem is built there is probably what decides whether the lake is a good lake or not, or a healthy lake or not, and the water quality in the lake. So these are more important than the size of the lake. Bigger lakes are difficult to manage, whereas smaller lakes are easy to handle.
There's one other question. We lost several lakes in the city, and how do you suggest to take steps to retain them? What is your experience working on BBMP, working with BBMP on encroachments? Many lakes in the
city are lost. Our own ward, like I said, we have many more lakes. So we are, how we are trying to protect is, you know, the same way we're trying to create citizen groups around each lake. So we believe in local communities for local lakes. So we are building more citizen groups. So Jalposhan will only take care of Jakur Lake. So we have an Agrahara Lake Group, Tirumanandi Lake Group, Venkateshpura Lake Group. So we have started a lot more, and we share knowledge and all the base information with them so that they are easy to start off, kickstart, and take care of the lake. With regard to working with BBMP, we are very fortunate. Like, Usha from Puttenally Lake, set the path for us. You know, she was the first one to speak to BBMP and put in this idea of citizens working with BBMP. And I think Mr. Satish, who was the then chief engineer, he was very pro-citizen and a very good gentleman who always, listened to ideas and let us, execute them. So the same is continuing now. The current chief engineer, Mr. Mohan, is also very cooperative and a very pro-citizen person who listens to you, discusses about things. So when we have good bureaucrats, in the lakes division, it's very easy for citizens to collaborate. But, the easy way out of this, our personal experience at Jalposhan has been that always, never accuse people. If you go to a government department and say, you're not doing the job, so I am here to do your job, that will never work, Always, there are problems, because sometimes there are genuine problems. They are they are understaffed, there's no budget, there are so many problems, and then nobody to help them out, So we have to go and become the part of the solution, not become part of the problem by bringing more problem on the table. But saying that, I'm not saying that we should not, file PILs or fight for the right things. We need to when that becomes inevitable, but not take that as a first step. Initially, try to work with the government department. If it doesn't work, try activism and the legal way. That would be the better way to approach them and work with them.
Ramaswamy has asked whether you had any industrial discharge coming into the lake in the past.
Fortunately, Yelahanka doesn't have any industries here. We just have these cottage industries which do some fabric dyeing, So occasionally we do receive these copper sulfate and, those kind of dyeing agents. But otherwise, we don't receive heavy, industrial waste. We only have domestic waste. That is why we don't have those major issues of sewage becoming a threat. Even if sewage is coming, it's more domestic sewage, which can be somehow managed, unlike industrial waste.
How are you managing the sewage waste? This is Kumar Tiwari here. How are you managing the sewage waste? Do you have any system to treat it and then let it inside the lake, or how do you do it?
Yeah, the STP that we have on the northernmost tip of the lake does all the domestic waste treating from the Yelahanka side. So whatever little bit we receive from the Agrahara site is also being pumped into the STP now. And any issues there, you deal it through the UGD department or the STP department. So most of the sewage is being treated and then only let into the lake. And the constructed wetland is a shock absorber. Anytime there is any accidental sewage entering, these constructed wetlands help, kind of filter them and make sure that the main water body is not disturbed. So whenever, there was heavy flooding in Lanka and we had to channelize all the water into the lake, also the constructed wetland really, really helped and ensured that there was minimal damage to the main water body. So that is being dealt by floating islands. We are doing a lot of small initiatives. We're also now planning on in-stream design of stormwater drains, whether some filtration can be done in the stormwater drain itself. So a lot of new projects are on the way. We are in discussion with the department to see the feasibility of making sure sewage is not coming, because that's the only threat today to Bangalore's lake. If we have zero sewage entering our lakes, all our lakes will become safe. So that is a big challenge, and we need to see what is the best solution for that.
Can I ask a question, Annapurna?
Yeah, please.
Yeah.
Annapurna, can you suggest? Yeah. Can you suggest? a mechanism where we can monitor the water quality coming out of the STP? Because in Agra Lake, now Agra, here HSR, we are getting the STP ready. And we were wondering how to, you know, coordinate with the BWSSB to get a water, this quality monitoring system. Any ideas, any suggestions?
The first thing about the treated water is, you know, the BWSSB mandatorily has to display the parameters every day. So if you go to the BWSSB unit any point of time, there would be a list of parameters displayed there. And if you feel that that is not, you know, you are not very comfortable with those numbers and you think there is something wrong, we normally send it to, you know, kind of, we ask ASPCB to come and do a sampling. And as I said, we are very fortunate that IASC and ATRI is working with us. So any point of time we have any issue, we also call them and ask them for their support. So they will send some researchers and they will pick some samples and test and tell us whether we have to press our panic button or whether things are okay and we can manage it. So having this scientific fraternity connected with you is a very, very important thing, because, you know, they will really tell you when to really panic and when not to. And they also probably can rationalize and tell you why small changes are happening. It could be seasonal or it could be because of some things. So they can tell you whether you need to really take action or you can wait and watch for some more time before you go ahead. So this is what we do consistently. So IASC and ATRI is doing continuous testing at the lake. So at any point of time, we can reach out to them and get the data.
Oh, excellent. Who in ATRI is?
ATRI, Priyanka Jambal, who is the water, you know, in charge of the water research there. She and her researchers are working at the lake.
All right.
Hello.
Right.
Thanks, Anupra. Can I clarify on the question that STP's orders on a turnkey basis? Presently, all the orders given to the contractors will be with 5 years at O&M. He is responsible to run the STP for the given quantity. So basically, all the vendors are responsible to run the STP for 5 years.
Has your turn come?
Hello.
All pay. 900, no?
Hello. So I didn't get your question.
The STPs are now run by the contractor for 5 years. The contracts are with 5 years of point.
Yes.
So the quality, he is responsible for the quality. So basically, it is the monitoring part of it. So MPSC, KPSCB also monitors it and they have to do that. So basically the answer is the quality is maintained by the contractor presently for 5 years.
Okay.
New STPs. Yeah. Okay, thank you.
So the maintenance keeps changing. You know, once the contractors can change, yet the parameters don't. And the BWSSB is responsible always. And here, you know, I would like to just add on key, you know, whenever we had any major issues with BWSSB, you know, the chairman also, you know, Shri Tushar Girnath has been very cooperative, he's always responded, come to the lake, done self, you know, inspections and made sure that some solution is, you know, there for resolving any problems. So I see that, you know, if you are kind of working together and your objectives are very clear about conservation and working in collaboration, I think people do respond well to your request and your they come and try to see the best that they can do to solve problems. Sometimes we need to have a little patience because, you know, in the governance, things don't happen very fast. You know, sometimes the time lags will be there. In the meantime, you have to see how the problem doesn't really affect your lake. So there's a lot of little bit of you know, working together as a team that needs to be done. A little give and take is necessary. We cannot always be very, you know, kind of strong-headed saying that it has to be my way or highway. We have to, you know, sometimes see, but make sure that it is all in the interest of the lake and the lake is not suffering at the end of your decisions.
So I guess there are no further questions. I would like to thank Annapurna for a very fascinating presentation. You have made it seem very simple, but I can sense the amount of hard work and perseverance that has gone behind it. It certainly came through in your talk. So all I can say right now is perhaps the Bangalore Navanirmana Party is definitely committed to conserving lakes, and we'll probably come back to you with more inputs for a specific manifesto as well. I hope you'll be able to help.
Yeah, so thank you for giving me an opportunity, and it's really always nice to share our experience, because we cannot reach out to all the 210 lakes of Bengaluru. So I hope today I've been able to at least bring a few more people to take care of their own community lakes. So thank you again for giving me an opportunity to interact with all of you, and let's all together save our lakes and conserve our lake one lake at a time. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Soumya, next time. Thank Soumya, you. Next time, some more questions from me.
Thank you, Manu.
Okay.